So, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this talk. It's brought to you by the Australian Friends of Palestine here in Adelaide. We have a series called Palestine Talks, and this is one of them. When they ask me to speak, I'm supposed to have done this in our centre here in Adelaide, but with the coronavirus, we decided to do it online, and I chose the day of May 15, obviously, because it's an important day. In terms of the commemoration of the Nakba. The title of my talk is really the message out of what I wanted to say, but I'm going to go and lay out the grounds before sort of I come to the conclusions at the end. The title is The Inevitability of Israel-Palestine Union. And there is an issue between, separation and union, and I'll address that towards the end. Those who don't know me, I'm Bassam Dally. I'm a Palestinian-Australian with Israeli citizenship. The rest of my family is still living there. Came to Australia at 27 and I've been active for the last 15 years in all sort of forms. I just want to start with a disclaimer, is that everything in this presentation is my own views, personal views. They do not represent AFOPA or any other organizations that I'm a member of. So I thought it's important that I say that at the start. As I mentioned before, May 15 is the day Palestinians commemorate al-Nakba. It has been 72 years of this position, where Palestinians lost their livelihood, lost their homes, lost their land. And in many instances became refugees, either internally displaced or in neighboring countries. It is a sad day for Palestinians. It's an important day as well, because it's a day where a lot of things have started in the story of Palestine. However, the struggle of the Palestinians, as I would address later on, is a century old. It did not start in 1948. Some photos I found in this, I think, Life magazine. It's called Documenting the Disposition and the Struggles that the Palestinians Went Through. So today I want to pay my respect to the 15,000 Palestinians who killed during the Nakba. I want to pay my respect to the 100,000 Palestinians who were killed since the Nakba. I want to sympathize with the 730,000 refugees who were dispossessed from their homes and left Palestine. And also sympathize with those internally displaced refugees, and many of you will be aware with the absent present law that Israel have instituted, where, you could, their village is declared as military zone, and you could see your house and you're holding your keys, but you can't go back home. Also, I want to remind everyone that 438 villages were destroyed. So there was an intentional campaign of destruction. It wasn't a war, it was an occupation and a disposition war. I pay my respect to the million Palestinians who were detained since 1967. That's a lot of people. And also to the 13.4 million Palestinians who live everywhere around the world, including in Palestine, of course, who have been fighting for an existential war for over a century, and they haven't given up yet. So for all of these people, I really pay my respect. I like this photo from Facebook I found today. They represent those who became refugees in 48 in particular. Of course, there's those who became refugees in 67. We're still carrying the keys to justice, as this hashtag says, and who are still hoping that one day they will go back home. So this talk has three parts. First, I'm going to do what I call reality check. I'm going to present where we're up to, what's happening now. And I look at list some of the resistance strategies. And I want to look how we're going to break this deadlock, or at least propose how to get out of the mess that the Palestinians are in these days. So let's do a reality check first. Here's a map from the Palestinian Central Bureau of Statistics. It shows the Palestinian population and the Jewish population in historical Palestine, so everything west of the Jordan River, from 1914 until today. So it's almost more than a century old, century sort of period. And you could see that today, number of Palestinians and number of Jews in historical Palestine is equal. It's very much the same. So in today's world, basically, there's equal number of Palestinians in historical Palestine. And this has value that I will speak about a little bit later. It's important to note this because Palestinians have not left their homes, have Palestinians stayed in their land. So where are the Palestinians? Well, 2 million of them live in the Gaza Strip. As you know, in 48, a few people from the south, or refugees from the south, fled to the Gaza Strip, and then which was then under Egyptian control. And then, so 66% of those living in the Gaza Strip are refugees from inside, who fled in there, and in 67, Israel obviously occupied the Gaza Strip again. It's a really a frightening number of the population density in the Gaza Strip. 5,533 people per square kilometer live in the Gaza Strip. So this is the most population, densely populated place on Earth. No wonder they're short of water, no wonder they're actually struggling to survive. In the West Bank, we have 2.7 million Palestinians living, and the population is one-tenth of that in the Gaza Strip. In East Jerusalem, can please mute the microphone? In East Jerusalem, there's around 300,000 live. As you may know, East Jerusalem was annexed in the 80s by Israel, and is now surrounded by settlements. And inside Israel itself, there's 1.9 million Palestinians living. They are second-class citizens, but they have Israeli citizenship. In terms of refugees, there's 5.6 million registered in UNRWA, and 28% of them live in 58 refugee camps. And around 1 million of them, my estimate, are stateless. You may know some of these refugees have become refugees for the fourth time. And the latest, of course, after the war and the civil war in Syria, they fled to Lebanon to stay in refugee camps in Lebanon. So in terms of the occupation, well, Israel today controls 85% of historical Palestine. And people don't know that Israel also controls 25% of the land of Gaza, simply because it creates this buffer zone along the whole border, which actually this is fertile land that Palestinians use for their agriculture, which they can't use due to the military control of Israel. There's 690,000 settlers now in the West Bank, including in East Jerusalem, with the 448 sites that Israel occupies. Now, as you all know, this is illegal under international law. Israel, I mentioned East Jerusalem before, and where around 300,000 settlers live in East Jerusalem. And I'll show you a map in a minute to show East Jerusalem. Area C is about to be annexed, which constitutes something like 30% of the West Bank. Gaza is obviously under siege since 2005. And every aspect of Palestinian life is being controlled by the Israeli military. So occupation has perfected the methods to control the Palestinian population and are in charge or in control of every aspect of their life. I put a couple of maps in here. The one on the left shows Jerusalem in particular. The yellow part is the boundaries of East Jerusalem under the Jordanian rule, which is 1967. And you could see the first thing that Israel did when it occupied the West Bank and East Jerusalem is to expand the municipality to where the blue line is now, and to fill this area with Jewish only settlements in there. The white part in here is where the old city of Jerusalem is. On the right, you could see the map of the West Bank. The The X's, the yellow X's are the Israeli settlements. And please note how it's spread all over the West Bank. It's not just in one area, it's in every area. The sort of maroon color in there is the Area C. That's what Israel is now intending to annex. In fact, I have to say Israel and the US are intending to annex. The US is sending experts to Israel to look at maps and to decide which part to annex and not annex. So the US, despite what they're saying, they're actually an active partner in the occupation of Palestine. Obviously, the rest of the area where green is where supposedly under Palestinian control, but we know what that means. Israeli military can access this land and this area anytime they want with impunity. I don't have to expand on this, but everybody knows about the wall. 8 meter high, 750 kilometer long. It's twice the length of the green line. It separates Palestinians from their land, separates Palestinians from Palestine. You're also aware that there was the International Court of Justice ruling about the wall, that it is illegal under international law, and that it ordered Israel to dismantle it and to compensate the Palestinians for their losses. Obviously, this did not happen, but there is a ruling which states that. And it's important to note that this wall and the settlement did not start under the right-wing Netanyahu government. It started well before that, when Labour was still in power. So this is an Israeli plan. It's not right or left-wing sort of plan. So what brings us then to apartheid? And this term has been used by many people, but I'd like to expand on it a little bit just to make sure that people do not hesitate to use this term when describing what's happening in the West Bank. So the term apartheid is not a slur word. It's actually a technical definition. It's a technical term which describes a system of institutionalized racial segregation. Obviously, it started in South Africa. And the rest of the world fought South African government to dismantle this racially based sort of control system. It's illegal under international law. The terms used by many people around the world and to describe exactly what's happening there. You may all be aware that Archbishop Desmond Tutu has described it as what's happening in occupied territories as Western. Edward Said eloquently stated that Israel is a democracy for the Jews and an apartheid for the Palestinians, and which is absolutely true. And even Jimmy Carter have written a book where he was frustrated that the Israelis did not adhere to what they promised after he signed the agreement with Egypt. And he wrote a book called The Palestine Peace, Not Apartheid. He could see that apartheid is coming in the occupied territories. But why sort of go to international statesmen when prime ministers of Israel describing it as apartheid? Here's a statement from Ehud Barak. Ehud Barak was a decorated soldier, chief of staff of the military, and also a prime minister. And he says, well, as long as in this territory west of the Jordan River, there's one political entity called Israel, and it is going to be either non-Jewish or non-democratic. Remember that many Zionists use Jewish and democratic all the time to describe Israel. So he continues to say, if the bloc of millions of Palestinians cannot vote, that will be an apartheid state. But Ehud Barak is describing exactly what's happening, is that there's millions of Palestinians who cannot vote, and they're all under Israeli control, one way or another. And hence, he's using the term apartheid. Ehud Olmert, who was also the Prime Minister of Israel, again was warning his people that if the two-state solution collapsed, Israel would face a South African-style struggle for equal voting rights. And he says as soon as that happens, the state of Israel is finished, in his view. He says Israel supporters abroad would quickly turn against such a state. Jewish organizations which were our power base in America will be the first to come out against us, because they will say they cannot support a state that doesn't support democracy and equal voting rights for all its citizens. We all know now that Israel is throwing democracy, down the drain, of course, and siding with autocratic regimes and right-wing extremists to be able to justify its existence in this racial sort of system. A couple of other quotes, and I'm sure most of you don't need convincing. Gideon Levy is the bravest journalist in Israel, and he writes for Haaretz, and he says, well, Israel is a democracy just as earlier South Africa was a democracy. Did anyone think of calling the regime in South Africa a democracy? So he's saying, well, you know, there's not much difference. Again, he states that when all these millions of people cannot vote, then he cannot call that democracy. It's basically an apartheid. Similarly, there's a quote here on the left from Noam Chomsky, which again, he sort of questions this Jewish and democratic component. And he says, Israel wants to be sort of democracy in the Western model, but if it calls itself a democracy, a Jewish state, it cannot be a democratic state, because in Israel, there are non-Jews who live in there and have rights. So I guess, you know, apartheid is a reality in Palestine. Now, just to try and illustrate the point a little bit further, and to hear it from the ideologues that actually trying to instigate the system, this is an extract from a documentary from Al Jazeera, which was supposed to talk about Area C. And in it, they interview a professor from Bar-Ilan University in Tel Aviv, which describes what really is happening on the ground. The interesting is, this is supposed to be a sort of an idea, but when this video goes on, you'd see that what he's describing is actually exactly what's happening.
Palestinians want their own state, but some Israelis have very different ideas about the future of the West Bank.
The real solution, which can work on the ground, is the Palestinian Emirates. We already have one Palestinian Emirate in Gaza. It has borders, it has government, it has whatever a state needs. We should establish another 7 states, emirates, on the West Bank. One in Jericho, one in Ramallah, one in the Arab part of Hebron, another one in Nablus, and so forth in Jenin, in Tulkarem, and in Qalqilya. Israel should forever remain in the rural areas in order to make sure that those mountains will never return into Hamas mountains. The Arab societies all over the Middle East are very much tribal societies. They live in the same place. They don't move from place to place generally. People are more loyal to the clan, to the tribe, more than they are loyal to the state. This will free them from Israel. Yet, Israel will be secure because Israel will be in the rural areas between the cities. This is the architecture. We have to solve some problems of water supply, of sewage, of roads, of accessibility to airport, to seaport. Okay, all these questions can be solved by peace.
And basically, what he's describing is simply Bantustan. An enclaves, an area which are surrounded by, he says, Israeli control. And then he says, we need to solve some problems, access to this, access to that, and we'll solve it via peace at the end, he says. In other words, peace for him is apartheid. He says that this is what he needs to do. So what's frightening about is why this is important, is that what he's describing is exactly what's happening on the ground, is that he's not talking about Area C at all. That's basically what Israel is doing now, is annexing. He doesn't talk about Jerusalem at all, which is Israel already annexed. And he's talking about full control and basically local autonomy where Palestinians live. So the point I'm trying to make out of this is that nothing that's happening in there is coincidental. All of this is part of a plan that has been ongoing since the occupation of 1967 and basically through Oslo. We all know how the settlements during Oslo have actually doubled and tripled rather than actually. I'm sorry that you couldn't hear the audio. So when the reality check, let's talk about politics now. I'm going to have to tell you that the Palestinian Authority basically is weak. It's trapped in the bubble of Oslo and is ineffective. Basically, it cannot stop Israel from executing and doing everything that's going. The Palestinian Authority is not allowed to even do a population survey in East Jerusalem, let alone provide services. So East Jerusalemites is actually almost left alone. Well, because Palestinian Authority can't access it. Obviously, there's political division between Hamas and Fatah, and that's making sort of national consistent strategy impossible, and the international community is using that as well. An important aspect as well is that the Palestinian economy dependent on foreign aid. Around $1 billion a year needs to come from somewhere, and the aid comes with strings attached. So political decisions are conditioned on aid as well. We all know that majority Sunni countries in the Middle East are being handed to collaborate with the US and Israel and to counter sort of this perceived Iranian threat. And unfortunately, in neighboring countries where Palestinians live as refugees, every time there's a conflict, Palestinians are being blamed for it. So they're always been, used as a scapegoat for every trouble that happens in Iraq or in Syria or in Lebanon. Internationally, the EU sort of usually pay lip service to the rights of the Palestinians, and many times their words are not followed by meaningful actions. It's illegal to manufacture products in settlements and to export them around the world. The only thing the EU does is label them rather than stopping from coming in the first place. They're threatening now sanctions if annexation happens, and that's yet to be seen. US foreign policy is the best described as erratic. And that we have a president who sees himself in biblical terms. He speaks to the Christian Zionist in the south, who sort of promised to elect him if he continues doing Israel's bidding. And this is this third point is important, is that over the years, the Zionist lobby externally and the Benjamin Netanyahu and his allies internally have decimated any reasonable voices in Israeli politics. It used to be what's called left and right. Now even somebody like Benjamin Gantz are regarded as supposedly left. There's nothing left about his policies or his attitude towards peace or the Palestinians. So there's a radicalization that happened to the population in Israel. And I use the terms racist and fascist ideology quite purposefully, because statements from people from the Prime Minister down is frightening in their attitude. The number of racist laws have been legislated in the Knesset are also testament to what the government is doing and what ideology they hold. And Israel has always been opportunist, so Benjamin Netanyahu jumps at opportunities to go to make friends with countries that agree with him. So no wonder he's a friend with the Brazilian president and with the Indian president and with the Australia and the UK. So, okay, well, this is reality, and reality big time. What are we doing about it, basically? What are the resistance strategies around the world that to counter this? War against the Palestinians have been ongoing for more than 100 years, and they are facing formidable enemies, of course, who broke every rule of the book to force them to surrender their rights and to live in freedom, peace, and dignity. I mean, 65, I think now, UN Security Council resolutions that Israel is in breach of. I don't think there's any other country in the world that is in breach of so many UN Security Council resolutions that is still allowed to trade and function. I could see the frustration in some of the commentators. Daniel Pipes and the Palestinians have not surrendered and they accepted all of Israeli terms. Jared Kushner the other day also, had disdain about the Palestinians and how they're still resisting and not accepting what Israel is offering. So important to also know that the Palestinian struggle over these have been the struggle of those who have are free souls who believe in justice and believe in equality. So Nelson Mandela, as said that our freedom is not complete without the freedom of the Palestinians. So there's a lot of solidarities where people who actually appreciate the values that we are struggling for. So what the Palestinians are doing, for them, existence is resistance. Despite the hardship and occupation, Palestinians still live in their land. And they are now equal in numbers to the Jews. This is an important fact. This actually also informs some of our activities here in Australia. We want to give the Palestinian hope. We want to support them to stay in their land. This is an important part because sooner or later, they will have their rights. And by staying in there where they are, that helps them in surviving and in getting their rights back. Many oppressed communities around the world better understand the struggle of the Palestinian these days, because and they understand it in what it is. It's a settler colonial policies and tactics. The Aborigines in Australia, the Black Africans in America, and so on around the world would see it to what it is. It's a struggle against colonialism. We need to remember that more than 75% of the earth population support the right of the Palestinians through their government and recognizing the state of Palestine. And that's important. It's important to know that. We do have the majority of the world's support for our freedom. And also, you know, despite the naysayers and so on, PDS is gaining traction worldwide. And no wonder that the Israeli government is doing everything it can to either smear or to prevent people from boycotting because it is effective. Solidarity groups around the world, like some of you and like here in Australia, including sort of Jewish groups, are supporting the Palestinians. So politicians are also lining up. And you know, when I was in APAN, it was pleasing to see how much support we have across the board. I have to say, not in the same numbers, but across the board. But some of them are, what we call, closet supporters. They're happy to support you behind the scenes rather than in public. Obviously, with social media these days, it's easier to organize and to disseminate information. And we've heard about the International Court of Criminal Court and the prosecution against Israeli actions that is now underway. And so using the international law framework is another important tool that the Palestinians are trying to use to take those perpetrators to account. Well, you know, I'll be lying to you to say that everything is rosy. Palestinians are politically and physically trapped. There's no two ways around it. Their houses are being demolished, their trees are being uprooted, their water is stolen, and their land is being confiscated. They are constantly under threat of detention, prosecution, or assassination. You may have heard yesterday that Mustafa Yassin was, you know, gunned down by security officers. His hands are tied. He's been tackled to the ground, and by one officer, and another one would put 6 bullets in his chest. And a doubt of these perpetrators would stand justice. This is a video evidence of it. His mother was only a few meters away standing. Trade with outside world is impossible for the Palestinians, and every aspect of their economy is controlled by the occupier. And that's a fact. And the Zionist lobby is weaponizing anti-Semitism, heavying governments to legislate to outlaw BDS, and smearing anyone who speak out in support of the Palestinians. And that's sort of basically here in the West and outside of Palestine. You all have heard about the case against Melissa Park is taking against the Zionist lobby in Ajax to clear her name of defamatory remarks they made against her just for calling Israel on its actions. So the question is, how do we break this deadlock? How do we get the Palestinians out of this trap? How to move forward, considering all the changes that happened over the last at least 20 years, if not the whole century? Well, I guess I hope I convinced you that there's no doubt in anybody's mind now that Israel's government has been actively working towards establishing an apartheid structure in the West Bank. There's no two ways around it. It's declared policy. Palestine's quest for a viable, contiguous, independent and sovereign state is now but a dream. Nobody should be fooling themselves that apartheid is independence. Isolated area connected by roads that you need the permission to take on is not a sovereign state. Pretending otherwise can be understood as colluding with the occupier. I'm not the one who accused people of betrayal and so on. But if we want to turn a blind eye to what's happening, then perhaps we actually doing the bidding. In my view, dismantling the leadership structures that came with Oslo will be essential to break this deadlock. We cannot continue on Oslo terms and expecting a different outcome to what we have happening since 1993. So, in my view, Palestinians need to charter a new road that guarantees equal rights for all. And how that should happen? Well, in Palestine, I believe that we need to dismantle the PA and reactivate the PLO with widest representation. PLO is the Palestinian Liberation Organization. It's the one organization that united all Palestinians from the early 60s. And that took him all the way up to Oslo and to that agreement. The PA was supposed to replace the PLO, but the PA now is ineffective in its current form. And if we want to have true representation for Palestinians, then the PLO needed to be reactivated. We need to form a strong collaboration engagement with the joint list inside Israel. So the Palestinians in Israel are organized. They have one party, and this party has 15 members in the Knesset. They are fighting for their rights as well. But what's interesting is that the struggle for rights is the same. This person who was killed yesterday was a Palestinian with Israeli citizenship. He wasn't in the West Bank or in the Gaza Strip. It's the same method of control, it's the same policies, it doesn't matter where you live. So I believe that we need to reach out to Jewish groups in Israel and forge a non-violent, well-coordinated and targeted grassroots campaigns. Jews in Israel want peace just the same as Palestinians. They have been led to believe that there's no way that peace will ever happen, and hence the only way to live is live by the gun. That's not the way to live, because we all know history tells us if you live by the gun, you die by the gun. That's not the way to live. I know that the Israeli society eventually going to wake up and realize that the only way forward is equality, is justice, is fair go and democracy. This is what we're expecting in the year 2020. So I believe we should advocate for equal rights under binational state system. It's not the only country in the world, it's not the first country in the world, and then everybody's right will be respected, including those of the refugees, of course. And then, of course, we need to gather support from the international community for this to happen. Around the world, obviously, we don't have the right to dictate to the Palestinians what to do or not to do, but we have the right to advocate for justice. We have the right to advocate for international law. We have the right to advocate for freedom, for equality. And hence, how do you do it? BDS is one of the major strategies that we have been doing and continue to do, because it does force people to ask questions. It does make a difference, and we need to continue doing that. We need to also engage in a broader sector of society as much as possible. There's a lot of communities around Australia and in the West who care about human rights, who actually are willing to listen and to understand what's happening and to actually be positive contributors towards a solution. We need to develop stronger ties with Jewish groups in particular, who subscribe to democracy with justice. And there's no contradiction of being either Jewish or Muslim or Christian or any atheist for that matter for you to advocate for equality and for justice. And we need to lobby politicians and to see that this approach is consistent with our values of justice, equality and freedom. We're not asking for anything but that, and hence we have solid grounds to stand on if we're advocating for equality for all. Let me finish by thanking you all for your attention and for your interest and for being here. I'm really humbled to see so many people attending and coming to listen. I'll be happy to answer questions. I'll try and go to the chat and see if there's any questions.